light 'em up.
Drops it back to Suter. His shot is good. Panic to Skid. It's tough to contain. And the Wild hang on to win their fourth home game in a row. 4-3 for the Wild.
We are back for another installment of Wild Wednesdays. Scott Schweitz along with Sarah Sheely, Tony Dean, and Kendall Marks. So we got a full house here at Bennett's.
Did you just say Marks?
He added an S. Don't be that guy.
My name.
Don't be that guy.
Kendall
Sorry,
Marks.
Continue.
Wow, I've
Kendall, the second show I did with him, he forgot.
90 seconds in, I've already made a mistake. All right. Mark.
Thank you.
No S.
Thank you. Did that intro super pump anybody else up or what?
I'm fired up.
Fallout Boy is like married to the NHL. They involved them in the All-Star game. They are on the video games before the songs. Like, I knew Fall Out Boy before Fall Out Boy was anything because it was on the NHL game from EA Sports.
See, I knew Fall Out Boy before Fall Out Boy was anything because I was like 13 when they came out. And I was like, oh my God, boy band. That's not a real boy band.
Yes. But it does have like a great kind of rhythm. And then that particular song, they played in the All-Star game and they broke out the flamethrowers and everything.
I'm going to give Aaron a shout out on that one because we threw him this afternoon that he needed to put something together and he did a killer job. And I just wish that we could watch a game right now. I'm fired up. Let's do this.
Just all so ballads. I love ballads. I love like powerful music, inspiring music, and Follow Boy tends to be that, like they have music that not only applies to just the radio, but then it ends up in movies or it ends up on the soundtrack or something like that. I wish they would update the music a little bit at the Excel Center.
Like that kind of stuff would be great. Yeah, I mean, like, man, that's a motivating charge as opposed to like the old school. Now they have last night, they have updated the clips. So the movie clips, they used to have the Happy Gilmore clip. It's like, you know, like, come on, let's make some noise.
Right.
They now have Charlie Coyle from the Wilds golf event, and he's doing the Happy Gilmore where he's getting people to make some noise, and then he hits the ball. So they've ripped off the movie, but made it personal with players. So that was one thing I did notice. But you're right. Every year they put out a survey about what do you think of the music? What do you think about this? And if for some reason it's never improved, I don't understand.
Safe zone. This is Minnesota. This is like we don't have like a rap music station. They keep going out of business.
Hey, no.
They have not true. 105.
Not true. 105.1 has rap music. I somehow came upon it, and I was listening to like Tupac from
somehow
All Eyes on Me.
Somehow came upon it. I can't get my husband to turn it off. It's driving me insane.
Yes. But that's like an old school. Like we don't
What's wrong with All Eyes on Me?
Well, no. I'm saying major markets. You go to Miami. You go to Chicago. You go to L.A. You go to New York, and they have like now appropriate like hip hop and R&B and like club stations and stuff like that. And here you have Cool 108. Like we're stuck on Cool 108 here. And it's because it's safe. You know, I mean,
the only station I think I listen to on the actual radio is maybe 93X on my way to work. Otherwise it's like XM radio. That's all I can handle.
I mean, ultimately it's great because it presents the opportunity for alternative media such as a podcast or
that's true.
You know,
Today on my drive to work, I was listening to Kendall and Kevin's show.
He was also listening to that in the bathroom, he told us.
Yes, aww. I did. And I will say,
flattering.
This goes out to Kevin because when I heard it, I'm like, listen to stuff in the bathroom. And all of a sudden I'm like, oh, this guy.
Sure.
Like half of it was when I was getting ready for work, got in the truck as soon as it synced up. I didn't even have to do anything. On came the voices just magically.
Fantastic.
So then on the rest of the way in, I'm
really happy you listened to my voice when you're in the shitter and when you are.
No.
There it is.
No,
it was enough.
No, to clarify,
it was enough.
To clarify, the bathroom. The bathroom is where the sinks are. The sinks are in the bathroom.
Yeah.
The place where the shitter is is actually called the stool closet.
Oh, you fancy?
Oh, you didn't. That's right.
If you didn't know, Lord Schweitz.
Very fancy.
Very literal about his interior decorating and how it has to be.
I bought a
OCD
model.
A little bit.
I had no choice, but on the plans, I laughed. I'm like, stool closet.
stool closet. It, yeah, I live in a tiny apartment in Uptown. We don't have a stool closet. We have a bathroom closet.
Yeah.
I mean, you could call it that for how small it is. So.
But really, really, what normal folks say is it's the shitter.
The lavatory.
It's the shitter. You're in the shitter. The like, what are you?
The loo.
Yeah.
If you're, if you're British, the loo.
If you're fancy.
The water closet.
The fancy. WC. El baño.
You know, I caught the show as well, and I think that it's a great opportunity for another show on the network to cross promote. I think it's great that you're here with us. I tweeted out a picture of who I had in my download queue because I'm trying to help people to understand that you can subscribe to our show. You can subscribe to the Sports Ticket. You can put it in your podcast, or you can subscribe on there so that it's shipped to you so you don't miss an episode. And so I took a picture of that. I took a picture of the process because I think some technology is lost on some people that would listen to our show if they knew how to do it. I think
it's like a play-by-play.
I did see that. I saw you put that out there, and when I went on your show today, I didn't realize there were so many different choices. Like, you can set things up in queue, so this will play next, and then you put that. I mean, it's more than I ever probably would.
It's just automatically under that podcast app. Like, you just go
iTunes.
In and there.
Through iTunes. Through iTunes, and it
then
was
there. It is. I had my my number one fan, Connie, at work. She's not
shouts
so into
out to
the,
Connie.
Shouts out to Connie. She's not so into the technologies anymore. And I showed her how to do it, and she listens to every show live. I guarantee her and Merle are sitting at home listening to us right now. So
Connie,
I had to give them a shout out.
Connie's husband's name is Merle.
Connie and Merle.
Shouts out to Merle.
You don't understand how amazing Connie is.
Respect.
And their dog, Cookie. So
they for sure each have their own, like, Barca lounger chairs.
Oh, I guarantee they're sitting in them
TV
right
trays,
now.
Et cetera.
They get
for
down.
Sure.
They get down with the get down. I know.
They watch Wheel of Fortune.
I know
they're
what
amazing.
They do.
They watch every Wild game. That's what they watch.
I respect
huge
it.
Wild fans.
Well, when that's
and
not
I love
on.
Them, so.
Wheel of Fortune's on before the Wild game.
Right, or some sort of Lifetime movie. But Kendall, we're super excited to have you here tonight.
Did
whoa,
you just
uh-oh. Yes.
Okay,
that just offsets the
fact that I put an S after her name. That S is for snorting, actually.
Right now you're
and
dominating.
Swearing.
You are dominating
she's
the
Kendall,
podcast.
She's Kendall Marks because she swears and snores.
Aggressive.
She snorted and
okay.
She swears.
When you say I swear and snort, it could get taken so many different ways. So
no
if
doubt.
We could just rewind.
Snorting, not like not, there's not like white powder here. Like, she's not doing that. That's to be
that happens.
We got
elsewhere.
We got a
no,
cop.
It doesn't just, happen.
We got a cop here.
We
I mean,
have,
there's
we
no
a cop
snorting
here to make sure that stuff does not happen.
It's aggressive.
Thank God.
It's a good idea. It's good. Otherwise, it might. I don't know. I mean, Sarah. Sarah's
just crazy mom.
Crazy.
Watch out there at work.
You
never
know
what she's
I'll have.
Literally, this is how we party now. Is Wild Wednesday podcast.
This
like
is,
this is what it is.
I'm
just
raging.
random better. All right, on a serious somber note, you guys touched on it on your show on Monday, but the Minnesota sports world did lose one of their own, and it's a real tough loss. I'm not the biggest basketball fan. I do go to periodic games, but you can't help but love Flip Saunders. I mean, what his history in Minnesota, what he's brought to the Timberwolves prior, and then what he brought back to the Timberwolves, kind of reignited.
And the Gophers, too.
Reignited, absolutely, but reignited kind of, you know, what had maybe, you know, kind of fallen off, and got some pieces put in place, you know, for a better way forward. So real tough loss. And then today, news about Jerry Kill hanging it up effective immediately due to you know, health concerns. I didn't see the press conference, but I told you before the show.
It was hard to watch.
I thought that because of the timing, I figured the Flip Saunders passing had some effect, and then you told me that was addressed.
He did say something. I think someone asked him, and he said something along the lines of, "I can't lie and say that I didn't have something to do with it." It was the whole press conference was just hard to watch. He was fighting tears / crying the entire time, mm-hmm. and it was probably the most honest press conference that I've ever seen. I mean, he was so honest about the whole thing. His wife was standing right there, and you could just tell this is a decision that is just really going to weigh on him forever.
Well, and both of them. I mean, the outpour from people on Twitter, fans, players, former players. I mean, it just shows how much both of these individuals really had an impact. I mean, Flip on a larger scale because it was a longer time.
Well, he's a Minnesota.
I mean,
he'll
you're
be a
talking
legend,
about
a
here.
Legacy forever,
I mean,
you know,
mm-hmm. Kill did 30 years as a coach. I think with both of these guys, what's so comparable about both of these guys is that These are leaders of men. These are guys that provide opportunities. These are both guys that they created their legacy with the relationships that they developed and the way that they afforded people the opportunity to play the sport, to develop as people, to lose Flip like that so sudden. I mean, it's...
I think that was the thing with Flip too.
Cancer's a bastard.
Well, and the thing, and
in August they said it was treatable. You know, so then to come October and suddenly, I mean, I think everybody was pretty shocked. Mm-hmm. Other than, you know, anybody who was
well,
in
like
the
two
loop,
days before, the Wolves came out and said, and it was David Kahn that basically said, "I'm in contact. He will not be back this year, but I will be in regular contact. I appreciate it. You know, if you guys gave them their privacy."
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And then 2 days later, that you know, the news breaks about it. But you see tweets like from Kevin Garnett just sitting in his parking spot, just, you know, staring at it, and the impact that put on there.
Did you guys read the Dan Barrero story that he wrote? It was amazing. I mean, I cried the whole way through. I mean, I just feel like it was one of those people that everybody has a story about him. I mean, even I have a story about him, or anybody who wants to talk about him has some sort of story to say, and the things that are said about him and what a nice guy he is or was, and his legacy as that genuine human being, I think, is just... It's honest, mm-hmm. and it's true, and it's just, it's hard to lose. And
I think, Kendall, you told a story too, huh? Right?
Yeah, I did. I had, you know, I got to meet a few times with Fox, like when as a Fox Sports North girl, but before that, you know, when I was a kid, I was a huge basketball fan because I played basketball. My dad was my coach, so we watched a lot of that when it was KG, Cassell, Sprewell, like those guys killing it. But more than that, my mom owns a dance studio, and his daughters danced. So we would go to these dance competitions, and he would be there. He was there all the time. And to be honest, like, dads don't really go to dance competitions.
Right.
I get it. That's fine. My dad always went, and we would see him. My dad would always, like, punch me in the shoulder and be like, dude, hey, let's flip. Flip's here, you know? So just saying someone that is that busy and is that big of a, like, celebrity here in the Twin Cities is so open to going and spending that time to be with his kids. I mean, that just says so much about a person that isn't ever highlighted. You know, like, people don't know that about him.
Yeah.
I just, that was so fantastic, and it's, it truly was one of those things. I think when anybody heard, you kind of got like, I mean, I got a little choked up about
it,
you know?
For sure. My husband's a huge Timberwolves fan, and I mean, I thought I was going to cry. And I haven't seen my husband cry, and I don't, maybe ever, a couple times, maybe in our 10-year relationship. And I mean, I just think it was a hard hit to take for everybody, and my heart is definitely with the Timberwolves organization and his family and Minnesota as a whole. I think that we don't take these things lightly, and I think everybody's hurting.
That's exactly. I mean, Minnesota is unique in that regard, and I know that, and Tony, we've had it back and forth about maybe fans being too much of apologists sometimes, but I think it's just in our nature as people that we connect very closely with teams and with individuals that other markets maybe are like dismissive, and that they're just, it's just a person. It's just a plug and play guy. They're going to be gone in a couple of years. Who cares?
It's sure. Like a family.
And I mean, Mike Yeo, for instance. I mean, of all the heat that Mike Yeo has taken for different things, Mike Yeo went to his kid's game, that outdoor game that he played, you know, the Hail Mary and St. Thomas Academy, and he had a game for the Wild at the X 3 hours later. But he made sure that he went to that game and sat in the regular stands with everybody because it was important for him to be there for his kid. Mm-hmm. I mean, and that's kind of like the thing is, even though they are celebrities, they are coaches, or they are players, they're still out, you know, doing the normal parent, you know, stuff that parents do.
And certainly, I think you look at the impact, and you look at the way that they carry themselves as leaders and men. And you know, I think we all kind of aspire to be good at our business and to be good friends and to go out into the world and have this impact, but I think you always have to like try to make good on every relationship. I'm a husband and a father first, so I always worry that I'll be really good at my job, but I'll be a bad husband, or I'll be a bad father, or I'll miss those moments. You know, for our daughter, she does dance. And I take her to practices, and, you know, I can female dog a little bit about, you know, going to the show because she has, like, two dances out of, like, 37, and I got to watch everybody else's kids dance.
Did you just avoid the word bitch after we said shitter about 25
yes.
times?
Yes. No, you know what I'm doing? I'm high-siding because Kendall broke the seal. I'm saving mine.
That explicit button's going on there anyways now, guys.
The other thing is...
Break the seal and sit in that...
I have my minis in the building, and they're always watching, too, and I think that's the type of impact a guy like Flip Saunders has, and that's mm-hmm. the type of impact that Jerry Kill has, is that when you are so important and when you make such a big impact, mm-hmm. you're always being watched. So you have to walk it as you talk it. You have to live what you ask of other people. And I think both of those guys are heart and soul. I would never ask of you what I wouldn't do myself types of leaders and men.
Absolutely.
And that's why when you lose a Flip Saunders to lymphoma, when you lose Jerry Kill to health concerns, and you see that press conference, I think my wife accused me of having dust in my eye while I was watching it.
Yeah.
The reason it's so impactful is that these are guys that, beyond the sports aspect, impacted the lives of so many people.
100%. When I was in college, I interned at Gopher Sports, and it was Jerry Kill's first year here. Everyone was super excited. You know, Jerry Town was going up everywhere already. And he had his first seizure at my first football game I was working at. To be honest, I had no idea that it was part of his history, part of the package with him.
With the epilepsy.
At that point, yeah. And so, you know, I'm up in where all the media is, and everyone's just silent. And then everybody goes crazy. And the next day, we at Gopher Sports had already scheduled with them that we were going to go to the practice, and we were going to film practice and, like, see everything. And that was the day he talked to his players about, like, how many seizures he had had. And he was like, this isn't, you know, for any of the media. And we were literally, it was me as an intern in college and then my boss. And he's like, turn your camera off. And I'm like, okay, I don't know what to do.
Don't tell anybody
about
this.
Right? And I'm sitting there in the huddle, and he's there with these guys, and he's being so honest. And I mean, the amount that he'd had, he's like, I've had over 100 in the last so many days. Da-da-da-da. I mean, it was shocking, mind-blowing, and the amount of respect that those players had for him. I mean, I went back to my dorm and I called my dad, because he's like the biggest Gopher football fan ever, and I'm like, this is what just happened. He's like, yeah, that's amazing that this man can not only operate and make a good football team, but that
he just
has such an impact on these people. And like you said, you saw it today in that conference. It was painful. It was hard to watch, but I mean, you know, all blessings to him and his family. Like,
absolutely. All blessings to him. And, mm-hmm. and thoughts to the Saunders family and the basketball organization and the sports world in general, I think.
In Minnesota, I mean, beyond that, we just have a community feel here. So players like to come back here. I mean, you see it in every
Tory,
different sport that we
Kevin.
Have. I mean, across the board. I mean, mm-hmm. hockey players. I mean, Wes left.
Yep.
He went to Tampa Bay. I mean, mm-hmm. he coached in Tampa Bay under Barry Melrose. And then, obviously, that regime was dismissed, and he came back here. I mean, they put their roots in the ground here, and they decided that they want to stick around. So, I mean, I think it is very much a tight-knit, welcoming community that we have here. And it's something I guess we shouldn't really take for granted. I think a lot of times we do.
Amen.
But, all right, so... Now on to
savaging Pominville. Like, oh, that's definitely I had like immediately we should just talk about Pominville not scoring any goals at all, right?
No, we shouldn't.
No, we shouldn't.
No, we shouldn't. Okay. I mean, you'll
Sorry.
We have some
I thought that's what we were going
to. No, we have some tweet messages and questions that are going to allow you time to do your.
We promised to give you your time.
Pominville, but
I love to see Scott's reaction. I went on
Twitter, I'm like, can you just get this out of your system, like, today before we show up, so it's not just 40 minutes of Pominville blasting?
And my response was Bueller.
Because
I don't want to commit to anything. Why would I want to commit to anything?
No, I know, but it's if you look at how he stacks up, he's got 5 assists.
Go by the thing.
No, I'm just telling you, if you want to get – but it's 5 assists. I mean, yeah, he hasn't put up the score sheet yet.
Sure.
But he's – it's not like he's absolutely not contributing. Do I think he can play better? Absolutely. I think he can play better. Who do you plug and play in that position?
Charlie Coyle. I think you say Charlie Coyle. 100% you do.
I mean, you had Charlie Coyle down on the fourth line last night to kind of give him a little boost. Now you want to bump him up.
Which is weird because that...
It worked, though. But and even he said after. He knew exactly what Yo was doing there and what he meant there, and it worked.
People go in the doghouse. Zucker was in the doghouse for a while.
Not people, though. But not people, because the veterans don't go in the doghouse.
Not people. Just what... Are they not people?
The younger
the
players.
The aliens, they go in the doghouse.
Or the Devin set of,
the
oh, Devin set the of Gucci's.
Oh, he, okay. No, he deserved
the
to go
the
in.
Non-human hockey the, players.
But did he, though? I mean, it was...
Set of Gucci.
Granlund,
set of Gucci is...
be honest, Granlund was the worst player on that line, and he was the prize prospect, and set of Gucci ended up in the doghouse. And then you go forward and you look at the guys that end up in the doghouse. Zucker ends up in the doghouse, and Eric Howell ends up in the doghouse, and Charlie Coyle does. But when you have a primetime role or you're a veteran on this team, I just don't see a lot of accountability or a lessening of the role.
Believe me, I'm with
you. Or taking Pominville off of the
I'm with you on the accountability.
Play if he's not producing. And that's the one thing that it seems to be there's so much pushback when you call into question whether you have this many shots, you have this many opportunities, and you're not making good on it. Maybe it's time to give somebody else an opportunity.
Well, maybe right now with Grajovic out, they don't really have as many opportunities to juggle lines and move people around. And when we see him next week, then maybe we start to see a little bit of a line juggle and kind of what's going to work better. And,
agreed.
And Granlund as well on that line is not producing the way that he should be either. That line in general, I mean, Parisi obviously is killing it, but he can't carry the line by himself. You know, at some point, they're going to have to step up. We're 8 games in now, and it's time to see.
And hey, he's getting
different.
Nice. He's getting nice setups. And I will say, like the power play, for instance, the personnel on the power play may have not changed, but where they are has.
Yeah.
So now they're putting Pominville down low. They're not putting him on the point. You got Suter and you have Parisi that are kind of
point guys.
Kind of point guys, but then Parisi kind of goes, you know, towards the half wall a little bit. And,
right.
And that
it's different. It's like a diamond. It's more of a diamond.
And it's
system.
A flip. They do the flip back and forth with Suter and him back. I mean, I watched it a little bit last night, and then I looked. I'm like, oh my, we're Pominville. Oh, he's over there. Oh. There we go. So, I mean, they didn't pull him out, but they changed positioning a little bit.
Sure.
Do I still think there could be a better makeup or personnel
chemistry situation happening?
Yeah, I, of course. But you have to be careful with veterans because you see time and time again in the league, something happens to a veteran and they become a cancer and they have a no-move clause and they have an albatross as a contract and you can't do anything. And it really can divide a locker room. It can create just really bad vibes.
Yeah.
So you do it. You do it. You got to tiptoe it.
But I guess the only it's systemic. So I think it's more a symptom of Yo and personnel decisions and coaching than it is of a player, because a player is gonna stay in the role that they're assigned, right?
Sorry, Scott just had to stop the whole show
to
order himself another summit. It was pretty
I didn't stop the whole show. It was very subtle.
I noticed he didn't offer anybody else. Yeah, anybody else like another summit?
You're all adults.
Just Scott.
You're all adults.
You're all adults.
Kendall would also like another summit or another Oktoberfest.
That's an order. That's an in-show order from Lord Schweitz.
And by the way, if you noticed, those of you who are loyal viewers, I am drinking the EPA. I'm not drinking my traditional Blue Mountain beer, because we're trying to woo.
We're courting.
Yeah, wooing.
And also because we just really love Summit. It's a delightful beer.
100%.
It has a lot more flavor.
Summit's also a St. Paul company.
I drink too many of them. I'll get kind of loopy, and then I'll just go off the rails.
The brewery is less than a mile from here.
I'll wander there later.
And why not have them partner up with Bennett's? Support the Wild Wednesday show. Make sure that we cross promote with Kendall's show.
Hey.
We've discovered that Kendall has a little ghetto streak in her, and it comes
like it.
Out once in a while. So you'll hear it.
Oh,
you'll hear it
is.
Come out.
Yeah.
How did I know you were going to bring that?
Oh, it's going to go for sure. I'm waiting for it to be like
Lord Schweitz.
We're going to say something, and all of a sudden she's going to be like, "Oh hell no!" Like, she's like. She's like this petite blonde girl, and all of a sudden,
I don't know if I've ever been called petite.
She's
in my life,
and
so
she's
I'm
gonna
just
start.
Like frame
and she's gonna
this
start.
Moment.
She just starts snapping her fingers at me pretty
it.
Soon.
You know, Kendall,
she's gonna speak about something soon too.
There's another snort.
I'm
That's
gonna
two.
Speak about that.
That's two. Two
I'm,
on the board.
I'm gonna speak on that.
Kendall,
there it is.
So what I wanted to ask.
That's what we need. We need the clip from like Airplane where the guy's like, "Shit, golly." Subtitle.
Airplane
Golly.
Is such an old reference. Nobody. None
yeah,
of the
I don't
kids,
know what that means.
None
actually.
Of the kids
I,
know
I
Airplane.
Literally have no
it's a loss. Actually, coach. It's not because they still break it out. I mean, Wisconsin uses it as their travel ad. They got like they got Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and the pilot from Airplane.
I don't go to Wisconsin.
But I don't either.
It's on their.
I refuse.
It's on their
literally
media.
Like
it's on their media
one place I will not go.
No.
Yeah.
I have to drive through there sometimes, and I plug my nose the whole time.
I just drive around.
I feel like
I
they want
to
pull us over. I feel like they want to get us.
They do.
I feel like they seek us out.
It's hard.
If I'm flying over, I just close the window. Can you just let me know when we're past Wisconsin, please?
It's statist.
Thanks.
Statist.
Jeez. And you know what? If the flight attendants from Minnesota, they always understand.
They get it.
They get it.
Mm-hmm. My mama was a flight attendant. She would have rolled your window down real fast. Like, yeah, let's just shut that. Nobody needs to see any of that.
They actually just come on over real fast. Just so everybody knows, we're about to fly over state lines.
So Kendall,
close your windows.
I wanted to ask you about this. So there's no more Fox Sports North girls.
Nope.
But
they killed it.
Well, there is. They're just not called. Well, I mean, she's still here.
No, it's gone.
She's just
The thing is gone. The thing is gone. And it was gone. And
uh-oh.
What I saw was there was this attack on it, like as if you're not aspiring,
professionals. Right.
You're not educated in sports. You're not passionate sports people, and you were just an instrument of the Fox Sports Network, and so that's the way it played on social media. Instead, I think what has shown with you still being there is that you don't have to call us the Fox Sports North girls. We're still going to be here. We're still going to be hardworking. We're still going to try to come out here and contribute to broadcasts.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about what...
you want me to speak on that?
What Fox... yeah, can you?
Yeah.
She can speak on that.
Because, I mean, I was like, no chance that you guys aren't passionate, you girls, ladies.
We get
people.
It. Okay.
Yeah.
Who are you calling ladies? You people.
You peeps, you homies.
Already.
I wanted to do the Queen Latifah thing, but I wasn't going to do it.
No, you know, I 100% I get what you're saying too. I think so. The Fox Sports girls were nationwide. There were 11 different sectors of us, I guess you can say. Some of them, I think, were a little less a part of the community than we were. You know, which is fine. They really, you know, they were the model type, and I think that that's kind of where that came from. I will say the women who were Fox Sports North girls out of, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think there were like 7 of us all together at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. 6 of us were journalism majors. I mean, it's not like we were girls that they just like plunked off the street. I mean, this was something that we all knew. It was a great opportunity. It was a stepping stone to where we wanted to get to. But none of us took it as more than that. And I think that people had that misconception that, and these girls think that they're, you know, they're all that and a bag of rice. Like, I don't even know, you know, but
I got upset because it seemed like they were
like
bag of rice.
Sorry, yeah, it's bag of chips. Is that the Red Wing version?
Wild rice is pretty big.
That was literally the Minnesota version of that. But
I try.
We
you know.
Keep going.
I try.
I felt like it was very unfair for them to just decide that it was misogynistic. And it was
great word.
Totally.
It was,
you know,
something that you were being taken advantage of,
exactly,
or something like that.
Women in sports, though. It's impossible for a lot of people to believe that maybe women really do love sports and women can make a difference in the sports community.
Not now, though. I mean, there's so many.
You have
more people that can. The people that ruin it is the girls from ESPN that are the pretty girls on the sidelines.
But look at K-Fan. There's not one woman on K-Fan all day long.
And not only that, if a lady came on here and either one of us were creepy, Sarah would call us out.
I would kick your ass.
If we made somebody feel uncomfortable, or we diminished anybody with regard to how they carry themselves in the conversation, or we tried to make them feel like lesser, Sarah would destroy us. And I think there is still
I'm
a lot
you
of
know
that.
Your place.
She's a scary person.
Well,
scary.
I got
person.
My boss lady over my shoulder. She don't take no shit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Funny thing is, we don't hear from Sarah's husband. Like, he very well could cry in the basement as well.
Well, yeah.
We don't know that.
Well, he's married. That's how marriage works.
Probably does.
Probably.
Eventually,
no,
you'll
I,
have
I cry in no basement.
I think
yeah,
that.
Yeah, you do. You have a
you
man cave.
I have a
man cave.
Check pictures of his man cave. It's like handcrafted.
It's a loft.
It's unbelievable.
You cry in your loft, yes.
It's my sanctuary.
Stop. I'm trying to speak on that.
Yes. Trying to speak on that.
I'm trying to speak on that.
I totally get what you're saying. I think that afterwards, the thing that was crazy was once we were cut nationwide, it was all on the same day, you know, everything was just done. Because I think, and I agree, it was probably just the easiest way for Fox Sports to do it, you know. We were the only region that media actually contacted and were like, hey, what happened? What they had to say maybe wasn't always the most positive thing. But people were genuinely interested. And I really think that that speaks on all of us who were part of it. Like, we were talking earlier on the show, like Jenny Taft. I mean, she works for Fox Sports 1 now. She's one of, like, she's
Dope.
Killing it out there.
Dope.
Clearly the woman knows what she's talking about and actually knows what's up. You know, I do stuff like this. I still work with the Wild. You know, I'm a huge sports fan. I always have been. I was such a tomboy that I didn't even own a dress till I was like 14. And my mother is listening to this right now.
Yeah.
And she can speak on that.
She can speak on that.
Seriously. I mean, and Angie, she's doing a prep sports show. She's working for the Vikings right now. Like, our intention was never to be what people always thought, which was, you know, like, oh, you're just girls with boobs that have nothing to say.
Like an FSN cheerleader.
Eye candy.
Right? And yeah, it was kind of one of those, like, well, of course I'm going to have my hair done and I'm going to wear makeup.
I'm on friggin' TV.
I'm on TV.
So
and
does
I'm
Anthony LaPanta. I mean, what's
right.
the difference?
Oh, care. So there was, don't. He's the hair apparent. Don't be messing with that.
Can't mess with the beer either. You gotta,
Summit.
Did you try to take his beer?
No.
But, I mean, it was just, it was.
Cleanse.
It was one of those things where it was like, we could never have said anything less aggressive. We could have never said anything less like, okay, we literally told you to tune in and support your favorite teams.
Yeah. Sure.
Like, there was nothing that we did that was any sort of controversial. But it is what it is. People
are going
to hate.
It's Minnesota.
Hate is going to
hate.
It's Minnesota. People decided that you were victims and they had to, like, stand up for you.
You needed to be saved.
And I'm like, you know, I'm 25 years old. I'm a full-grown woman. Like, I pay my bills. I'm fine. Thank you.
Well, why don't we talk about the things that you are doing? So you have a show with Gore.
To pay your bills.
Well, yeah. No, let's talk about what you are still doing. Because, I'm proud of you. I think you're doing great. So.
Thank you. Gosh. Yeah. Afterwards, it was a little bit of a struggle, you know. And I had a lot of connections with people in the industry that we just met, like, once or twice. That it was like, hey, you know, just reached out. And as of September 1st, all these crazy things happen. I'd always had a great relationship with Korg. Like, mm-hmm. he's always like, you're like my kid sister, or like my kid, you know?
Yeah.
And so we have the show, The Sports Ticket, and then here on Alive and Social. And then I work for the Minnesota Wild. I do their in-arena hosting. So, you know, if you're at the game and the person that's like, hey, Wild fans, or does surf during intermission, that's me sometimes.
Yay!
Not all the time, but hey. Yeah. Like, on Friday, I'll be there. So if you're there, just say, what's up? I do that, and then my full-time gig, I still have a contract with Fox Sports North, by the way, so I do random stuff. Like, I did a Twins viewing party this last season.
Okay.
Stuff like that, and my full-time job, I work for airviews.com. It's like YouTube for aerial footage, so drone footage.
Cool.
I run the news department, so I'm the producer and the anchor of everything that comes out.
Wow.
Hence my journalism major, like, coming into play, but it's a lot.
You're a busy lady.
Oh, my gosh. I don't even know. Like, I don't have time to pee some days or eat. Like, I get home sometimes, and my boyfriend will look at me. He's like, have you eaten today? And I'm like, I don't know. I can't remember. So, like, he just knows now to, like,
have food
there for me.
It's way better than
if
he asked if you peed
me
today. That would be just awkward.
I know. And then I'll be like, oh, my God, I haven't peed yet today. And then I, like, you know, go do that. But
in the water closet.
In the shitter. The loo.
I'm proud of you.
Well, that's great, and I'm happy to hear that you're staying busy with all
Thank
sorts of
you.
Sports-related things and
drones.
Staying in the know, and drones. So we'll
it was good to see you guys come kind of not pop back up, but just kind of reemerge, because it was a very swift, like, guillotine that was dropped.
Oh, yeah.
And just went, oh, now they're gone.
I cried. I mean, yep. You basically are fired from your job. You don't have a job anymore. Hey, selfie time. Smile. But basically,
this is something. This is really trying.
Right now,
we need to buy Tony a selfie stick.
Seriously,
the ladies at the table next to us
I have one.
She's scared.
I'll bring it next week.
She was actually frightened you were going to drop it on her head.
Honestly,
ruin her night.
Not impressed at all. Okay, so let's talk about the last four games. What have we done since last Wednesday?
We should.
We did
a lot.
Beat Anaheim Saturday. Got our revenge on Anaheim.
You missed one. You missed an important one.
I know. What did I miss?
Missed Columbus.
We survived. God, we talked so much.
We
about
survived
them last
Torts
week.
Coming into town with his loud voice and his antics, and we survived that game.
And
that
inspired
was
a
hey.
Team.
That was speaking of your in game. That was your first one, right?
Wait, I'm sorry. I
on
I'm
Thursday.
Totally looking up at
Thursday when
yeah,
we played the
was.
Blue Jackets. That
yeah,
was your
it
first
was.
Game.
It was.
Right on.
Sorry, I get when I'm honestly when I'm working the game, I'm so stressed out the entire time that I'm like, it's hilarious that I don't break into like canker sores and blisters and hives, because I'm so stressed out that literally until the last like 2 minutes of the game, so like third period, I'm pretty calm, but I still like have a job to do. I finally I'm a little puddle on the floor, like, oh my God, I survived. It's
like,
scary. It's scarier
I made
than
it
people
through.
Listen to you.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Seriously, it makes me want to pee my pants, but.
That
yes.
was a good. I mean, that was a good
I mean,
game.
That's I how think many that. People listen to Wild Wednesday. What do you mean?
I don't understand.
They're on the edge of their seat until the last 2 minutes, and then they're okay. Okay, we survived.
Exactly.
There wasn't that many F bombs. We're good.
Yeah.
Okay,
so
but
we survived them.
We survived Columbus, leaving them a continuing zero in the win column, which is fabulous.
Nice.
Anaheim, redemption against a team that, for some reason, they just can't score this year.
They're bad.
I mean, they've been shut out like five times, and it's just, they're awful.
I think maybe more than five. Maybe
awful.
Right, five. Yeah, well, no, it's really bad. It's they're having a tough time, and they've got some injuries now, too, and it's just.
And I don't know exactly. I mean, not as many. I mean, the Blues are the ones that are injury-plagued, if you want to talk about injury-plagued. They're the ones that really are hurting. But Anaheim was picked in the beginning of the year to dominate.
Yeah.
And not just the Western Conference, but Stanley Cup favorite
yeah.
in a lot of circles. And they've been shut out, yeah, five times. I mean, it's ridiculous. With
wow.
that firepower, it's crazy.
And with them, they're really working on getting their coach fired. Even
well,
though,
that's what I was going to say.
Even though they
yeah,
came
Bruce,
out.
Bruce Boudreau is going to not make it through the month of October.
Well, what will happen with him is if they do fire him, he'll get picked up in Pittsburgh or somewhere else. He won't be unemployed for
no,
very
no,
long.
He won't be. But, it, I mean, that's unfortunately what you have to do because you can't. We've talked about it in the past. You can't dump a team. You have to bring in people. And John Davidson talked about bringing Tortorella in, and they needed a new voice, and they needed a loud voice, and that's why he was the guy. You couldn't just get another coach. I mean, Todd Richards was a little bit more soft-spoken, but you needed somebody that could come in and rattle some cages, and that was his goal in bringing him.
I mean, is Tortorella the guy, though? I mean, is
I think he's going
to
be the
I don't,
guy.
I mean, I don't know if he's the guy. But
I think he's the guy to shake it up with.
I love that they got their
like
first win in Colorado.
Oh,
yeah,
that's fabulous. Because you got two nut jobs across the, you know, the glass from each other. So you got one. Whoever loses is going to have a temper tantrum.
I mean, I'll always take pleasure in the Avalanche and their fans' misery. Like,
oh.
I will always go out of my way to just be like, oh, you lost to the Blue or the
Ooh,
Blue Jackets?
Sad.
Ooh,
rough.
It's too bad. Too bad.
Terrible.
For you.
Ouch. So that was the last team to not have a win, right?
Yep, that was it. And then your favorite Canadian team, the Montreal Canadiens, they did get handed their first loss
last night.
Yeah,
Carey Price wasn't on his game last night. Well, did you hear that he took a slap shot to the throat in Monday's practice?
Probably hurts.
Nasty.
Probably hurts
a
little bit.
Took a slap shot to the throat, hit the ice, and was just down and out for minutes.
That's a scary thing.
I don't know
if
that had anything to do with it.
You hear all the time. I mean, Dumba. Dumba was rifling shots at Dubnyk last season, and he rifled one. I think he caught him in the shoulder or something, but Dubnyk, like, folded over. And Dumba was quoted to say, like, he had a no-shit moment because he saw everybody. Fletcher was watching the practice like, oh, God.
Well, the Canadians
oh God,
did not
I just
release
hurt, I just no hurt the
shit.
Savior. Now my life is over. I'm going to be in Iowa
over.
Forever.
The Canadians
Ever.
Did not release
Savior.
Who did it, but could you imagine being the guy who takes out Carey frickin' Price in practice? Like, he's out for the season, slap shot to the throat. Like, could you imagine? They didn't say who it was. But
yeah, I mean, obviously.
And to the throat just, like, adds
oh my gosh,
so much
like just,
to it.
Like,
to
the
throat.
Throat. That just sounds horrible. So, happy to hear he's okay, but did seem off his game a little bit last night. But they're so hot, it's unbelievable. They're just out of control.
I think people don't appreciate, if you've never played the game or you've never been, like, on the ice, how dangerous it is to have a puck flying at you. I had my nose broken before. I've been just destroyed by, like, body checks before. Scott, you talked about last week.
People at work think I'm absolutely crazy for wearing a half shield. They're like, you don't play professional hockey. Why do you wear a half shield? Like, well, because I'm just used to it. They're like, what if a puck hits you in the face? And I said, well, I hope it doesn't.
Yeah.
Like, I don't go
Fingers
out there.
Crossed.
I don't go out there be like, yeah. You know, today I think I'm going to take one in the chin. I think that's what my – but it does, and it's – I mean, hopefully you don't get a stick or a puck to the
I
face.
I mean,
but
it kind of surprises me because I know that you really appreciate that pretty face of yours
yeah,
and those
that's right.
pretty teeth. So
pretty.
It kind of shocks me that you don't protect those teeth a little bit more.
Well, I have – I mean, yeah, the good mouth guard. I'm not taking shots like –
It's
like
a good dental plan.
Like Crosby, you know. Crosby took the slap shot to the mouth and knocked out half of his, you
yeah,
know,
right,
his
enough,
chiclets. I mean, but
that's
I don't know who you're playing
yeah,
with,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah.
I don't want
that's
that
unbelievable.
I don't want that to happen. I don't think people are rifling slap shots like that when they're in beer league hockey playing at 10:30 at night.
Yeah, fair enough.
I mean, I don't think. Maybe. I mean,
here's
if it does happen, I'll let you know. I'll I'll come here, you know, flopping my gums.
You don't choose to take a puck to the face. It chooses you. Like, you
karma.
You do
it
very,
chooses you.
Yeah. I took
I'm a good enough person that it still hasn't hit me yet because a puck will find me if I'm a bad person.
That's weird. It must not be about karma then.
Oh.
Nice.
Puck's going to find you.
Hey-o.
I took a puck to the nose, blew up my nose one time. I woke up just like crying. I was like, why am I crying? Oh, my nose is blown up. Thanks.
Oh, I broke my nose.
Sad.
Turns out I didn't get out of the way.
A purple face.
I've never had a puck to anything, and I don't plan on ever having a puck to any part of my body.
Keep an eye out.
Yeah, it's your rogue pucks flying in St. Paul all over.
Same.
But speaking of
you've
karma.
You've taken elbows, though. You play basketball before. You've taken elbows.
Oh, my God.
Elbows.
You know what I got every single year? I'm not even. This is like not. No joke. No joke. This is maybe where.
I'm going to speak on that.
Here
I'm
going to
speak on that. I would go to basketball camps. I would go to different leagues. I did, like, everything. Because when you're a kid, like, you go gung-ho, right? I got the Blood and Guts Award, like, or the Defender of the Year Award.
Charges.
Everything I ever did.
Taking charges?
Because, no, my dad was always like, Kendall, you know, and this is, like, I'm a kid. Like, I'm, like, fifth, sixth, seventh grader. And he's like, you got a big butt. Just stick it into her.
Oh,
if she wants the ball, you just stick that over there. Yep. You just throw an elbow. And he showed me like all these little tricks that you could do to like pinch people. Like I would do this thing where if I'm checking, like pushing out a girl, like boxing out a girl from the hip
box
check
out.
Sort of side.
Box out, yeah.
Yeah, I'd like
wish
pinch
this was
her.
On camera right
I'd
now.
Pinch
I really
her in
wish
the hip.
This was on camera right now.
Oh my God. And these girls would be like, they, you know, they're young. So they'd look over and be like, Daddy, to their dad on the sideline. What's she doing making her stuff? And I'd be like, it's called a box out, bitch.
Yes.
Like running down the court.
Yes.
So it's, I don't even know how we just got into that. But
1,000%. No, I like it.
1,000%.
Dad's like, you need to get in there.
You be a defender.
You need to knock that lady
you
down.
You throw some elbows, girl. Oh,
throw the back end around. See, then maybe that contributes to, I don't know. It's
sure.
The swag.
You got a little attitude. You got the big swag. Ass. Maybe you're like, nice. Yeah, here we go. Now it's making
it
some
feels
sense.
Dirty. It feels dirty when you say it, Lord Schweitzer.
So
it feels
dirty.
Sounds better.
Everything he says sounds
big
dirty.
Big ass
if
and
you
attitude.
Wanna see, if you want to see
ass
Kendall's
attitude.
Box out, it is on our Snapchat story.
Oh, good. Did you get like the wiggle?
Oh, yeah. It's real good.
No doubt.
It's real good.
So
what happened Sunday, though?
Now, I want to talk about that because...
you want to speak on that?
I want to speak on that because if I start saying that, I'm going to be really mad. Like,
that's
like
giving
my thing. I'm going to speak on this.
It's imprinting.
Somebody works going to be like, why are you talking
I'm
like this?
I'm going to speak on that.
That's my evil plan.
How does Winnipeg only get out of that game, by the way, with the... Like the league minimum fine, or what it was, it maximum? It was like $4,000.
Maximum fine.
$4,000.
One thing I got. So the maximum
on the elbow
fine
on Spurgeon
is $4,500.
Yeah.
I said that's
like the max fine.
I joked with Sarah, like we were emailing. I'm like, like that's like if I fined her $5 for being Canadian. Like, that's nothing.
Wouldn't be the first
that's
time I
nothing
got that
to
fine.
A guy making that much money.
Especially
that's silly.
Especially since that guy was in the KHL. He left the team because he didn't want to play nice with others. Was making millions of dollars in the KHL as one of the stars, and then came back this year. So it was Burmistrov.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so the other thing about that play, which I thought was kind of genius of him, is that he does the whole thing like, who, me, it's not me.
Me?
Watches the replay.
Oh, like, the bot.
That was me. That's exactly what he did.
That was on Twitter, and they had the reaction from him. It was pretty good.
And he's like, what? I didn't do that. And then he sees it, and he's like, never mind.
Because you
I'll
see.
It.
It's good.
I did that.
You see guys go off, and they do all that tough guy puffing out the chest, and, you know.
Bufflin, I don't know how. I mean, he hit your boy. He hit your boy.
That pissed me off.
But who? You want to talk about Big Butt? I mean, he throws his dumper right into Pominville's head.
Dumper. When you call it a dumper, I love that you said dumper because it makes it. That's a grody dude
it's
term.
It's actually really gross. I don't like
dumper.
It.
But he did. He like tossed it. His big ass like right at Palmer's head and smashed it against the boards.
With that. You've got 2 minutes left. That is just a typical Bufflin selfish penalty at the end of the game. He does it in like every single game.
Well,
I can't
like,
take it.
What, God, what is his name? Ott. That's just like, ugh. Freaking odd.
Steve
like,
the
why
Pirate.
Do you even
they
have
call him Steve the Pirate.
You are so incredibly. Have you guys ever seen that? There was
a
30 for 30, I think, thing on ESPN. It was like the last gladiators.
Yeah.
And it was all about
fighters.
Those guys. Yeah. All the fighters that, you know, were like, hey, I wasn't good enough to make it, so I became a fighter. Did I want to do
it? These guys aren't even
no.
fighters,
the
though. They're not even
the
fighters.
No, they're just jerks.
These guys are just, I mean, I don't even classify them as agitators. But, I mean, Bufflin's just an asshole.
Yeah,
I mean, he's an asshole that does cheap things and isn't penalized for it. I don't know why.
Think that there's two. That there's a difference between Ott and Bufflin, though. I think Ott is dirtier than Bufflin.
Mm-hmm.
I don't agree with that.
I think Ott isn't very good at hockey. So his
it's like an ogre.
He's not very good at hockey.
Oglethorpe.
So his dirtiness sticks out a lot
I think
more.
Bufflin can't control his own emotions.
Bufflin
I think
is
he gets
jerk.
So pissed
oh, yeah.
off
no,
and
he
can't control
too,
it and he
too
does
far.
Stupid shit. I'm not saying he's not
too
dirty.
Far. There it
yeah.
is.
I'm just saying that maybe it's from emotion, not from actually trying to be dirty. You know mm-hmm. what I mean?
When
you have to be able to control
I hate
it.
His
I mean,
guts. I'm not saying I don't hate his guts. I'm just when you're putting him in the likes of odds, I think it's a little different.
1,000%. You can tell without having like a close personal relationship with Dustin Bufflin that he's one of those guys that thinks I do what I do and then you do what you can do about it.
Well,
so what
you,
he's decided
penalty.
Is
he's a bully.
I'm going to come out on
bully.
The playground. I'm going to knock
yep.
you down in front of the girl that you like
Boom.
Because I can do that. And then until you respond to me, I'm going to continue to do this. Like
he's O'Doyle.
Our guy,
O'Doyle rules.
Our
that's
guy,
what he basically is going to shove some kid in a locker,
yes.
you know, and full of hay and poop.
And that's why he throws our guy, Peter Pan, up against the glass and hurts him, and then nobody does anything about Finnish.
But at what point?
Also
at
known
what point
as Finnish Baby
NHL
Jesus.
Finally.
No, Finnish Baby Jesus.
He's Chucky.
Yeah.
He looks like the Chucky doll.
He kind of looks like Chucky. He looks like Finnish Chucky.
I'm getting Finnish whiplash Chucky. Looking between the two of you. So if you could just, like, take it down a notch.
Once they get
my
going.
Neck would.
She's had instructions to have us simmer down if it's ever too much.
I'm just going
to
throw
it
out there.
That's why, that's why this was a strategic, like, placement. So that. They yeah. can intervene.
I'm so happy to have her here. I need this, sister. But at what point does the NHL finally, like, send a small message?
They won't.
Never.
I mean, they, okay,
this
they
flyover
did,
territory.
Yeah, they did with the one guy. Where was it, like, seventh?
Who's
going to
be?
Suspension?
I need to know. Who's
going to be? That fucking asshole.
No, who's
that
Whoa,
asshole?
There it is.
Yes.
Winner.
Who's
yes.
the Adrian Peterson of the NHL? Like, who's going to be the guy that, like, Ray Rice goes and fucks it up, so he's going to, like, go hit
there
his
it is,
wife?
Followed by her.
Oh,
well played.
Sorry.
Nope.
Yeah, okay.
Too late.
So
you
that happened. That just happened. Anyway, so Ray Rice goes
to Tony, that. Tony and I are, like, the genuine purists over here. You
so,
guys are the potty mouths.
I'm so good
Annie,
at it,
I'm trying. You
sorry,
too.
Just,
I just need to,
just
like,
speak
get,
about it,
Aaron,
sister.
You know that duct tape you have over speak there? Can I have
it.
Some of that? That'd be great.
Hold on, Aaron. I do have something for this.
Nope.
That's my shut the F up whistle.
Oh,
okay.
I like that. Okay. So, you know, Ray Rice goes and like goes and screws everything up, right? And they find him like nothing. Let's say like that's our comparison to Ray Rice. Something like that happens. Who's going to be the Adrian Peterson of the NHL that everyone's going to be like, oh my God, it finally happened. Somebody
when you
got
make an
totally
example
screwed.
Of?
Exactly.
I don't honestly think that Bettman has the seeds to do that.
It would have to be a player that matters though.
That's
like,
what I'm saying. Like,
well,
Adrian Peterson's
Rafi Torres.
It has to be, yeah, you know, and I agree. If you suspend guys that are bottom of the roster, the
Nobody
goons
cares.
Of the world, they expect to be suspended. If you take a guy like Bacchus. Who,
like Kane.
Or
why
Kane.
Not do it like Patrick
oh.
Kane? Hey, he might have just raped somebody.
By the way, on 93X this morning,
NHL
funniest thing, they go on Friday, practice it with me. She said no.
Oh,
and like they're like,
see, and to be honest, I don't like that.
And but
to
they,
be real.
But they,
and I hope that you guys
they're
aren't
stealing
that
from
right.
another arena
no,
that did it to her.
It was from they did it in
Philly,
and they did it in New York. And to be honest,
that's
I don't
Bush
like
League.
That because
that's Bush League.
You
because
both.
What if
you,
that really happened?
It makes
you know
light
I mean?
Of it.
And
yeah,
you're
yeah,
making
yeah.
a joke about this girl, and I don't know if it did happen. I don't know if it didn't. I try to make no opinions either way. But like, what if it did? And then you have 50,000 people cheering that. Like, who cares about? Effing Patrick Kane, okay? I hate that guy. But what about this girl, you know?
Minnesota,
we're classier than that.
But
the
NHL hasn't set a very good precedence for holding people accountable
no, it's,
for
they
off
know.
Of the ice events.
But he's a direct example of somebody that you can make an example of because
yeah.
he is a huge player.
And you want
and
to talk about
the problem
it.
Is
and
though,
they
that
didn't.
Case is so sketchy.
And he's a repeat offender.
No,
yes.
It's
yes.
He's a repeat
he's
offender.
He's a repeat offender.
He beat up the cabbie with the roller quarters.
He's not a repeat offender of sexual assault.
But he's a repeat
Let's be clear.
But he's a repeat offender
that you know
of conduct true. Unbecoming and hurting
well,
the
that was
league.
That was a military thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And but you look at the NHL and they haven't done a very good job of holding players accountable because if you look at the goaltender in Colorado, Varlamov, he gets arrested for domestic violence and then the charge
because he's Russian.
But the charge goes away because the girlfriend ends up back in Russia. It's just amazing. She's no longer participating in the prosecution or the investigation because she magically ended up on a plane back to
Mother Russia,
Vladimir Putin land, where you, if you're the goalie for the Russian Olympic team, turns out your domestic violence charge just magically disappears.
I think that we should just send Patrick Wah there, too.
I know.
Oh, I like that.
Thank you. He's my wah-wah.
Well, like when that. He gets fired from this job, he probably doesn't get another job because he was tied so closely to
this
that
job?
Organization. Or that organization, right? Colorado and Sakic in general.
I mean,
so maybe Sakic he does coach him in the KHL.
They don't make the playoffs this year. He's done.
They'll move him probably to some other position, though. I mean, those two are like... I mean, they're like a two-person boy band up there in Colorado.
I don't know. Can you do that, though, really?
I don't know.
They do it here. They do it here in Minnesota. If you're one of our guys, you don't actually get fired. You end up like Bill Smith reassigned to a thing, and then Terry Ryan comes back, and Gardenhire doesn't get fired ever.
That's the Twins. I mean, the Twins are probably the worst example of that.
But Minnesota's a great example of if you're a nice guy, you don't get fired because you're a nice guy. Because we're very passive aggressive.
Maybe hold on a little too long.
We've gone U-turn on like what we talked about at the beginning of the show. We were all kind of like,
no, you were. I was never on board with that.
You weren't.
You were misty. I'm going to bring over the boss, and she's going to talk about how you were like getting misty earlier.
Well, of Kill. But you know what? I'm not a Gopher football fan. I'm a Notre Dame football fan.
Yeah, no,
what is wrong with you?
You are not.
Don't sit across from me. You smell funny.
I know.
Go away.
Wow.
That wasn't mature.
My grandpa, nice. It was aggressive. I liked it.
Thank
you.
It was
a total immaturity thing. Like, oh, yeah? Well, you're ugly.
It doesn't hurt my feelings because I'm not a Gopher football fan, so I know what it feels like to not, like, you know, Music City Bowl. Here we come.
Oh.
Our friendship literally took a hit.
So, you know, that's what I'm saying. Like, you didn't, nothing was wrong with you until about 30 seconds ago. Now, all of a sudden,
that's debatable,
like,
Kendall. You just haven't been here long
enough. No. I was hiding it. It was in lurk.
You've only been here for 40 minutes.
But then you threw the Gophers under the bus, and I'm like,
I didn't throw the Gophers under
clear.
The bus.
Be clear. Like, you smell funny. I don't want to sit by
you respect
anymore.
Kill, but the Gophers are never going
to
be, like, nationally relevant football program.
I want you to sit on the
Ever.
Front of the bus,
Ever.
And I'm going to sit in
That's
the back of the bus.
Not
the
everybody
that is true.
Hey, I'm sorry, Tony. Not
like
everybody
outcast.
Can jump on a bandwagon like Notre Dame, okay?
Well, I've been a Notre Dame fan. Actually, I have a Fighting Irishman on my arm that I got when I was 18, the day I turned 18.
How long ago were you 18?
A long time ago.
Could you give me, like, a reference?
16 years. I just did math. 32.
Really fast.
Yeah.
That's 34.
That's aggressive.
34.
Don't be so hateful. You know.
You said Notre Dame. And
yeah,
I
you
should
have left the Notre Dame thing out.
Notre,
I know.
Notre Dame.
So my grandparents come from the south side of Chicago. I've been watching Notre Dame since I was in diapers. So I've always been
I'm gonna defend him because my nephew goes to Notre Dame, so I'll defend him a little bit.
I mean, I hate Notre Dame, but I married a Yankees fan, so because he's been a Yankees fan his entire life. So if it's a lifelong thing, I feel like there's instances.
Yeah.
Hell no, with no Packers bullshit.
I will say I am dating a Hawks fan. Like, no, I know. He's from Rockford, Illinois. He can't, like, help himself. You should have seen it. I made him sleep. I legitimately.
But now he lives here.
Made him
Transplant.
Sleep on the couch. When we lost last year and we got swept, he was like, honey, because he'd be like, yes, every time they'd score. And I was like, I swear to God, Jordan, if you say that one more time, you're getting your ass out of this.
That's
moment.
Right, Jordan.
Like, I'm going to kill you. He's probably listening right now. And he's like, yeah, I remember
he's
that.
Like,
that was bad.
Best night on the couch
know.
Ever,
I
too. He was probably
like
thinking
can.
About it. Like, I'll take a win to sleep on the couch.
Like, I hate you. Oh, God.
I just
bad.
Feel like I don't even know how to respond to that. Because that's like the Blackhawks to me are the same as like the Packers.
You
like,
should
I
have
mean,
covered this before.
You just can't.
I know.
That is like. He must be hot. I mean, there's just no crossing
nice.
His line.
Hey, babe, I mean, how hot is he?
Honey.
No, we need to know how hot he is.
I don't need to.
He's a
you need to.
Man.
I don't need to.
He's a beautiful man.
I will
he
give
must
him
be.
That.
He
like,
must be a great
like
guy
Aaron.
To be forgiven
Aaron
for
is
being
a beautiful man.
Fan.
There it is.
Well, I brought him to the Hawks Wild game last year in Chicago, and this is at the point that, like, you know, it was the very end of the season in April, and the Wild won, and I'm, like, the only Wild
fan. When the Blackhawks
were
just starting to play.
Right. So... The Wild win, and, like, I, you know, they get up and cheer, and I'm, like, sitting on my ass. And, like, I got my Brodine sweater on, and I'm like, yeah, screw all of you. Oh, and then we won the game. And he at one point was like, Kendall, sit down. Good. And he's like, you are embarrassing me. I'm like, no, I'm not. I mean, shit, I spent, like, $500 on these tickets. I'm going to celebrate.
I like it.
They should have to own that shit.
So I had that, you know, it was our last, like, the preface for the whole series – and then we got swept, and he would like, yes, and he'd like punch around and like jump up, and I was like, I swear to God, like, I'm about to cut your knees off, like, this is happening. And like, he knows when I get that look to like just
That's
stay
enough.
Away.
You just sit down.
Just stay away.
Smart.
I think the ghetto
is not just superficial. Like it's aggressive. It's all the way to the bone.
It's aggressive.
It's Dinky Town ghetto. Like it's not real ghetto.
You're
gonna shoot Dinky Town.
You decide what
dinky
cutting somebody's knees
off. It's yeah. Red Wing ghetto, guys.
I have the Red Wing hick and I have Dinky Town ghetto. It's like this nice smorgasbord.
Great word.
That's nice.
Great word.
Like going to Pizza Ranch. You want pizza or you want fried chicken? Whatever.
I don't like that we glazed over the fact that Aaron is just a beautiful man.
There it is.
I love the fact that
you're bringing it back up.
We're looking better. Because Aaron's
uncomfortable now.
Is an eligible bachelor. We need to get a picture
Aaron
of him.
Aaron needs to be ready for his weekly Snapchat.
Look at how
He's
good. Look at how you see
That's
how
the best.
I took a picture. It was a bad selfie of the show. Aaron, immaculate in the photo.
What's wrong with you?
Unbelievable.
You guys are embarrassing me. Stop it.
So, Aaron, well, do you ever spell your name with the second A as a heart? Because I just did.
that's
so aggressive.
That was amazing.
If you want to check him out, he's on our Snapchat.
Just so you know.
You should check him out.
I still have, like, I swear, Aaron, I'm about to embarrass you real hard. Are you ready?
Real hard.
Okay. So when I real had good. Angie.
Brace yourself.
When I had Angie Vestris on the show, because KG is like always off with the team and stuff, and so I had her on the show, and she's a former Fox Sports North girl too, right? Aaron, we did not have the same like rapport as we do right now, because like she was on the show and I swear you got like white faced and not talking to me, and I don't appreciate it, and I just want you to know if she ever I'm looking at you.
Did you get nervous?
Don't point at yourself.
It's all right.
I have this plan.
She's a good looking person.
I think he's going to marry Anki.
Oh, I like it.
It takes me a little time to warm up. I'm shy at first.
Yeah, especially if she's hot.
Yeah,
it's
definitely.
Okay. Scott and Tony probably would have acted the exact same way. So,
no, we would have just talked about
no,
us.
No, I wouldn't have. No.
We would have talked about us. Okay. Have you met us? Like
that would have made her uncomfortable. She'd be like, "Don't you want to talk about me? I'm pretty." I'd be like, "Nah, let's talk about me instead."
That guy didn't ask me one question about myself ever.
I'm just gonna keep drinking.
Yes. Yay!
That's what we do around here.
All right, let's.
So last night.
Last night, we had the, in the intro, by the way, it will continue to pimp Aaron because that intro was badass, and
I
loved
it. Point.
It
was on point.
But last night, there were some really, really good plays that we did. There were some really bad plays goaltending-wise. I mean, the goal that went off the glove and right under the crossbar for Dubnyk was just it was bad.
Yeah, that was rough.
But the silky smooth goal from Vanek to Scandella,
that was sick.
Such a great example of when a defenseman can come into the play. Mm-hmm. And contribute offensively. That's exactly what you need. And so, just a nice tip by a defenseman. Wonderful.
Yeah,
great.
Very, very underrated too. That Scandella can go end to end. I think.
Right.
He doesn't do it a lot because Scandella is our physical presence. He's the defensive, more defensive in his pairing, whether he's with Spurgeon or Dumba, or
Fair.
Even Prosser or Folan now. But when Scandella gets an opportunity to go end-to-end, he reminds me of, like, Brent Burns Light with regard to he has the size, he can take it himself, he can use his frame to create space. And
That's a great parallel. I love Burns. I mean, if we can get Burns back here,
I know, man.
Love Burns. But you're right. I mean, that's the first time I've ever thought about it that way, but he does have very Burns-esque qualities.
But with Scandella.
So thank you for that.
Scandella, he plays within the system. He
Scott
also
never thanks Tony either.
Ever.
Or agrees with you. So that was
ever.
Right,
what he does, he
so
undercuts
far.
Me. He undercuts better, me, but
better,
he does it nicely.
You better put that in your pocket.
I just felt like I was in therapy, honestly. Like, I feel good right now.
You know, like, my worlds collided
You're
last
welcome.
Night. Awesome.
Sorry, go ahead.
You're taking credit for this?
I'll stop now.
How are you taking credit for this?
Because, be clear, none of this happened before I came, and all of a sudden it's like...
Be clear!
Jesus.
Here it is again. Like, that is not anything like...
Who's the narcissist now? Be clear. You need to be clear,
Scott.
Look
at me, everybody. Look what I'm doing.
Here's what I'm saying.
Nobody's looking at me. I'm on the radio. I'm on a podcast. I'm over, like, voice.
The kid at the table over there with the pass flare is looking at you.
There's actually videos of you on Snapchat right now.
Other than that...
Baby Derek is staring at you right now.
He's got a nook nook in.
He's the future. He's the future of Minnesota hockey.
He's
maybe
the future of the Dean
or
franchise.
Dance. I don't know. Maybe you'll want to dance. Whatever. Don't. I'll be there.
Is baby Dean? Is baby Dean like the kid
I'll
from Look Who's
there.
Talking?
Oh, he's a
is
menace.
He like lunch?
I'm telling you, he woke up at 6:30 today and he was like, "Guess what? Our day started." And my wife was like, "Guess what? Your day started." Right. So then I take him, and then all day I think he was trying to get me to cry. Not because, like, he wants me to cry, but just because it's something to do. So he's, like, 5 months, and he already, like, is running the entire house.
Yeah, he's pretty cute. I didn't listen to anything you just said because I'm just looking at him.
I know. No.
That's nice. Look at that.
Better, it's
full
better
distraction.
That way. No.
So, Tony, you said your worlds collided last night.
Yeah, and so I saw this great quote. We watched an episode of Fargo, and I thought it was so genius. It was like worlds colliding. You know, the law enforcement, the Minnesota, and so the quote was on there is that you said the most polite, unfriendly thing to me in an unfriendly way. So I don't think that you're a friendly guy. I think you're calling me on my stuff, but you're doing it in a way that I can't be mad at you in the moment. And I think that that's like a Minnesota passive aggressive, like that's how we do it. We're like, yeah, no, I'll look into that.
For sure,
And what that means is, there's no chance I'm going to listen to your podcast. I think you're a jackass, but I'm not going to say that to you.
Because that would be hurtful.
I don't want to be hurtful.
And I just want to make it clear to people, if you want to say that to Tony, please do. And via Twitter, like,
I'll
we
only appreciate
all of those
it.
Things.
I will
absolutely.
Only. I think that's why on Twitter specifically.
Speaking of Twitter.
Yeah, we'll get those questions out in a minute.
Specifically on Twitter, right? I get this reputation for like starting fights or being like overly aggressive. But it's only because I can have somebody not agree with me and be okay with it, just like I can not agree with them and be okay with it, especially when it comes to like player performance and what's going on with the team or what I believe to be true. Because for whatever reason here in Minnesota, people want to have it said by somebody. And then it's the gospel. So if Michael Russo says it, or if Mike Yo says it, or Chuck Fletcher says it, then that's just how it is. And no, it's not, because we watch with our eyes, and we create content, and we create podcasts. I write for Hockey Buzz. And so the draw is that I'm going to write what I see, what I believe, what I know to be true according to me. If you disagree with me, I want you to. And then I want to foster a conversation. And I think that that's what's so smart about it. So with Marco Scandella, I think his role on the Minnesota Wild is kind of dictated by who he plays with. And so he activates and he has these genius moments. He breaks the hearts of the Blackhawks with that slap shot. You wonder why he doesn't get power play time. You wonder why you don't see more offense from Marco Scandella. And I think it has to do with his role on this team. And that always seems to be like the online Twitter argument is roles of players. So like when I start this huge thing that becomes a thing, and you know, people are like, maybe you should calm down a little bit on Twitter. It's only because I think that we should call into question if you believe that maybe Pominville shouldn't be on the power play, or maybe Charlie Coyle would play a great big body role with Parise's work ethic and with Granlund's slight frame and his playmaking ability. That those things should be said. Not that Yo cares, because Yo's the guy with his finger on the button. He's got his hands on the wheel. It depends on him. But conversations can be had where you disagree with somebody, and it doesn't mean that they have to be right and you have to be wrong. You can just agree
to
disagree.
Well, that's what Twitter's for.
Well, that's what conversations are. I mean, basically, you have...
Did I tie it in? Was it too much?
Was the longest one-spoken conversation I've ever heard on this show. So that, I mean, I like
Kendall,
it.
That's okay. Literally, that's why I have the whistle.
I know. No. And that's why you got, like, forewarned, because I...
But the thing about it is...
I liked it.
And then somebody else has a take, and no matter how you guys banter back and forth, you're going to have your opinion about that you're right. They're going to have their opinion about they're right.
It's
and that's
like politics
and, that's
and
it.
Religion. You just don't.
It's exactly
you
right.
Know.
But you'll never see a personal attack from me. You'll never see me try to diminish or make somebody feel like just because I don't agree with them that they're lesser.
No.
And I don't try to make somebody out to look crazy, because I think that that's disrespectful. Because I put in effort to write. You know, we put in effort to create the Wild Wednesday show. So if you don't agree with things that we do, it shouldn't minimize the fact that we're passionate, that we put forth effort. And I think that when you snipe and you're snarky and when you do stuff like that, and it makes everybody look bad. So that's been my one contention. That's why I, with the Wild Wednesday show, not only cross-promoting, but also giving people an opportunity. I think it's great to give people an opportunity. Everybody should have an opinion. Sports fans should have an opinion. Anybody that writes or creates media or that's, like, aspiring, you shouldn't have somebody come through and just shit on you and make you not want to put yourself out there or put your ideas and thoughts out there, because that's a shitty thing. And I think that especially, like, the Tom Powers of the world, you know, they can go online and shit on people, or they can be snarky to people and be proud of themselves. And it's like, so what, man? You know, bloggers
are
important.
Nobody cares.
Yeah, bloggers are important. You know, I mean, just because you write for the newspaper doesn't mean you're the end all be all, my guy.
So, okay, so here's some Twitter questions that came in today. Two of them are similar. So, first one from Mel_Mike, MELL_Mike, says, does Fontaine work in Palmer's place? And that's a question that we've talked about Fontaine's versatility in the past.
He's a Swiss Army knife.
He is. I mean, he's the corkscrew, he's the screwdriver, and he's the toothpick all in one. But, I mean, what do you...
No.
I think there's a better...
Just say no.
There's a better person that could be in that place than him. Now, the second...
Who?
I mean, you could put it... Ahead of Fontaine?
Yes, in that place.
Spot? I mean, without... And the problem is, if it's like
Extend
Domino.
Extend yourself. Say a name,
But if you disrupt other lines, that's the thing.
Just say a name, though. Who do you think could play in that line instead of Palmerville?
I mean, Coyle definitely could.
Okay.
Coyle could. When Graevac comes back, that will bring options.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, that's the thing. Do you sacrifice a line's...
Could you play Vanek there? Could you play Vanek with Parise and
I don't
Granlund?
Think Vanek's a good fit there. I think he's better on the line he's at. But he's obviously, with his success this
and
year.
He's doing great. We're exactly where
he's
at.
Yeah, I don't want to take away.
Vanek's creating a lot of
He's like third in first points, and he's second in first goals. Leave him alone. He's doing well.
Leave him alone. Yeah. He was a loser last season. Let's make him a winner this season.
Yeah. I mean, he was
injured, too.
He had the Schweitz.
He was.
He had a Schweitz.
He was the one that we were bagging on last year.
We didn't know that, though. I mean, general public speaking. Like, people didn't have any idea what was going on with him. I didn't really have any idea.
It's amazing to see. I mean, he had major abdominal surgery, though, in June to repair that sports
hernia.
That's
legit, by the way.
I mean, you see him now and see what he can do healthy. That's what I expected out of Thomas.
Exactly.
And
I think that's why people were so pissed off about it, because they were like, he's supposed to like come in here and save us.
I'm just like really happy that his groin is healed.
And goals. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, and goals. Like, he was supposed to be our sharpshooter.
Vanek and goals. And if the goals don't happen, then Vanek is the worst
who's
player.
Vanek? What's that?
All right, so here's the thing. So that was that's another question from Josh Wendell, J. Wendell, PGA. I got to give a plug to him. He is the pro out at Eagle Valley in Woodbury.
I saw
that. He invited us all to play some golf, swing the sticks.
Yeah,
golf.
Kendall.
And I said, is this still legit? Like, you guys are still – he's like, oh, yeah, we're going until the snow flies.
It's going to
snow
today.
Snow kind of flew today, but
– Does he know that I could put up, like, a 140, 120?
That's aggressive.
You and me both,
I could flutter.
In the cart.
I score what guys score that are, like, in the PGA Tour. You know how they score on, like, you know, several days? That's, like, my score for a day. But I enjoy the sport.
As long as you ride around the cart and you bring yourself some summits or whatever.
What a great time.
Oh, yeah.
So you ever bust out the kick wedge? I bet you're.
Oh,
are you a kick wedger?
The foot wedge?
The kick wedge?
No,
guys,
I do not.
You don't even know what my golf game is.
She just
like.
Picks it up and throws it.
Jordan's listening here, and he's like, she doesn't have a golf game. I don't know what she's
talking
about.
That's okay. We'll go golfing.
So Josh asked that exact thing. You know, do you put somebody else in Palmer's spot or to spark Palmer? And could you reunite him with Vanek?
Could you bump Palmerville down to the third line? I think you could.
I like the idea
with
of Vanek
and then bring
Vanek.
And then so you're just swapping Palmer for Coyle.
But you have
that
to
was what you do. You'd swap Palmer for Coyle and you bring him up from third to first. That would be an easy plug and play.
Parise loved playing with Coyle because Coyle
big
is very good on the boards. He's a net front presence. And Charlie Coyle works his ass off. That's
I think
why
Vanek and Palmerville have great chemistry, though. What if Vanek can maybe spark him and bring him back to where we need him to be?
The only thing is,
do you like Howell in the middle of that?
Defensively?
You need some speed you're going to pair them together.
So you have to have Graevac, and you have to have Graevac like, up to speed.
Or someone like Schrader.
Games under
like, just
his
someone
belt.
Fast.
Schrader, yeah.
Yeah, and The tough thing about that line, if you put Vanek and Bombenville together, that's the worst defensive line maybe ever
that's
of
true.
The
yo. You've got some bad decisions going on.
The thing about, I mean, if Hollow can play like he used to play, and he did good defensively, then it wouldn't be a worry. But you do have options as far as Schrader or Graevec, either way.
So
the last question is, I got one more. Hold on.
I have one more, too.
One more.
It was on the similar, but you just go ahead.
John, I'm going to totally butcher your last name, John. Tonjes?
Okay.
At Johntoenjes. Dubnyk's knee, overblown panicking or end-of-the-world scenario. I'm going to go the former, not the latter. I think it's basically, if there's nothing structurally damaged with his knee and he had an MRI and he's still rolling, I'm not going to worry. Because I will tell you this.
I think it's overblown, but if there is an issue with his knee, then yes, it is end-of-the-world.
Do you think this franchise would allow him to play if it was?
Okay, tell me this then. Backstrom not traveling as the backup, was that vindictive? Is that because they're sending him a message? Because why the hell was Darcy, or why the hell was Doobie the backup? If he's saying his knee hurts, Kemper starts, Kemper sucks, why the F is Doobie the one coming in then?
Because that's the thing, is if you're...
Why is Backstrom not even traveling?
Well, because they really want to keep him out of the mix. I mean, they don't even want to include him in anything.
Right, so is that sending a message? Is that because they're pissed?
What message are you going to send? I mean, he's stuck
with
us.
I'm just saying, but that's my point.
Our hands are tied.
We have three goalies, and you've got our star goalie, our star player that's holding everything together, saying that he has a knee injury.
Here's probably why
you're traveling, and he's not even the backup when you got Kemper, that you know he gives up a couple goals in that first period, and he's got to come out.
Because what happens if you bring Backstrom with... and he gets some sort of fictitious, weird little groin oblique something injury, and then he's on the shelf for how long when you're maybe trying to dangle.
I don't think he'd do that, though. He's such a proud guy. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, somebody like that.
At this point, does it really matter, though?
Right.
Literally, we're stuck with him no matter what.
The best thing that could happen to the Wild, though, is Backstrom gets hurt.
And LTIR?
And then you can put him on the LTIR, which is a long-term injury reserve. Yeah. And the reason...
For those of you at home that are playing acronym game.
They call that the Chris Pronger, right? So you could stash him there. He retires next year because he won't be in the NHL.
Right.
And then you get cap relief for the $3.7 million. The other thing is he's not in the lineup. He's not suiting up. He's not traveling with the team. Because 100% they're salty at him. And they're salty because he could have had surgery. He could have been
obviously
forthcoming.
We know why they're salty, but...
Yeah. He's on the outs. Like 100% the team is salty with him. The other thing is he's been available for trade all offseason. It's not helpful for his agent to come out and say he's requesting a trade. That's not helpful.
Yeah, we'd love to trade you.
Yes.
That would be our number one. That's a dream come true.
Show us a buyer or a dance partner.
Everybody loves having three goalies. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
I know.
It was great.
Nobody needs that roster spot.
Goalie tripod.
So I have a tweet from our friend Derek at State of Hockey News.
Derek Felska.
I gave you my non-spider-webbed phone.
I know, but you can't. I can't read that clear screen.
Just give me it back.
He said.
You'd rather read your destroyed iPhone.
Scott,
you don't have to be.
Nothing wrong with that.
The two of you are ridiculous.
Heard that? Okay, so he says, can Graevec anchor the second power play when he returns? # snarky rules.
No, I don't know. Can Graevec contribute at the NHL level? I don't think we know anything about that.
I think he can.
You think he can?
Yep.
I think he can.
How? Based on what?
Based on what we've seen.
What you've seen when?
I mean, with the exception of his injury.
Prospect camp?
I think a couple games in the preseason? I don't know if he can anchor the second power play, but I think that he can definitely contribute on an NHL level.
Yes.
I really like Graevec a lot. He was definitely the best player last year on the Iowa Wild team that was pretty miserable.
Well, that doesn't really say a whole lot, to be fair, but...
No.
Would you rather have him down in the Baby Wild or have him up here and get a chance?
No,
I mean, get him up here.
I see what you're saying. I think that for me, Graevec's kind of... To me, at this point...
if you don't know,
just, like,
now you know.
For power play purposes, he's like a Nino. Like, he's a big dude. He's going to be intimidated. He can sit right there. He can sit there right there on the net and, like, sit there and... I don't know, do his thing. But I think he's got a little better shot than that, too. Nino's got some moves. Like, don't get me wrong. It just...
Yeah.
I don't know. Sometimes it goes in and sometimes it doesn't with him. You never really know what you're going to get. And I think that hopefully, this is me like finger crossing both fingers right now. Graham, that can be that guy that can sit there too, but he can actually get every one of those shots. I don't know. He's a big kid. I think that really helps with that. Don't have that.
I'm excited to see what he does. Bring him back next Thursday against Nashville. I'm pumped.
So Derek's a smart hockey guy, and the reason he asks if Graevac can anchor the second power play is because you don't have a center on it. Right now, you're running out there. Thomas Vanek is taking faceoffs. You have some Zucker playing up top on the point, and he's doing faceoffs, but you don't have a center on the on the second power play because you have Granlund and you have Koivu together. And so
you got Coil.
I mean, but Coil's not a center.
I mean
he isn't.
Coil fills in at center,
but he plays well when he does.
The thing with him is that
I think he does. Coil, I think he does a great job filling.
He has moments.
Center.
He has moments, but he's
Coil,
not.
Coil, Granlund,
NHL
both
center.
Of them suck at taking the face off. Like everybody knows that. Like all we have is Koivu at this point.
Yeah.
For that, I mean, that was a huge problem all last year in the playoffs. It was like, who are we going to put in there? Oh, it's constantly Koivu because he's got to get back out there because, oh, well, somebody's got to take the face off.
And the
Granny
matchups.
Can't do it. And, Coil can't do it.
And Quinville used the matchups to his advantage. And they destroyed us on the face off. And really, we were getting destroyed on the face off in the St. Louis Blues series until Laterra got hurt his hand. And that was kind of a turning point, too. I think, Sarah, I don't mean to demean it. I think that Charlie Coyle's good at everything. And I think Charlie Coyle's a hard worker. I just don't think that he's an NHL center. I think he's better on the wing.
I don't think he is the NHL center. I'm saying that I think that he fills in well as the NHL center. That first Saturday night game when he played center, when they moved him over after the Graevic injury, he had 2 points. He had an assist and a goal right away. And I mean, he played well. He looked good.
Sure.
I think he can.
He's ambidextrous when it comes to hockey. He can play
anything.
I'm not
saying it's his best case scenario, but I do think that he does it well.
I also see that as the greatest weakness of this team right now is that they're missing a top six to top nine center because if you look at Granlund's production hasn't been matched up to like the superstar level of his hype. Especially last season. And then if you look at Koivu has had kind of a resurgence. And a lot of that has to do with playing with Jason Zucker because Jason Zucker is fast. He enters the zone.
And Nino. He's having a lot of fun playing with those two young guys.
Yes. And
he's
so
pumped up.
And Koivu also is playing in the paint, which I've like banged the table. I've like pleaded because he's our biggest body.
He's huge.
Up front, he needs to play in the paint. He needs to get in close, and he was like, he kind of floated on the perimeter, and he wanted to be a puck distributor, and it just wasn't working.
After everything that we said about him at the end of last season, and then when the season did end, and how we thought the Wild would move on, and how he was going to move on, and what was going to happen, and how we were surprised to maybe not see any possible attempts to move, or what we were going to do with him, and the liability that he was, kind of how we said it, and now I think he's the best player. He's playing the best out of everybody on the team right now.
Which
is tough to say. I mean, Parisi, obviously,
Parisi's Parisi. He's just different.
But, I mean, I just think that Mikko really is the best player on this team right now.
And that line has been the best line. The Mikko, Nino, and Jason Zucker line
absolutely.
Has been the other contention was that.
What was that game? They had 27 shots.
Just unbelievable.
On that line.
Big.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's an entire game. That's one line.
And it's work. And they were putting in the work. I would just say that what we've seen from that line is that Jason Zucker is always going to use his energy and effort. And he gets people off the puck. Nino is a big body. And he works hard in both ends. And then what Jason Zucker didn't do when he wasn't scoring goals, he got his first goal the other night, and it was filthy.
In 10 seconds.
10 seconds. He goes around a prize defenseman, Jacob Trouba, for the Jets, who Trouba was the guy that they were like, why do we draft Dumba if Truba's out there? He undresses Trouba, and then he puts it backhand over Hutchinson, which is just unbelievable. But when Zucker wasn't scoring goals, he was finding his teammates. He was creating offense. And I think you can see some of the same things that Thomas Vanek does, creating offense out of nothing, finding teammates, setting teammates up. We've been seeing that out of Zucker. He's been finding Koivu in the slot. He's been finding Nino all over the ice and creating offense. And that's something that it didn't seem like. It seemed like he would just be like a speedy guy goal scorer.
Well, I think that we can all agree that it's been a funner team to watch in the last few games. Let's talk about what we have coming up here. We've got Friday night, first game against your boys, Blackhawks.
They're not – oh, I was like, they're not my boys. Yeah. Oh, yeah, my boys.
Your boys, Blackhawks.
Pretty Jordan and his Blackhawks.
Yeah, so we have Blackhawks Friday and then Saturday. Who do we have Saturday?
Saturday we go on the road.
On the road. Blackhawks Friday, Saturday –
St. Louis,
you're right. And then we have another five-game stint until Thursday, which I hate. This is, once again, five-day break until we play again on Thursday, which is frustrating. But
well, I mean, you can argue schedule all day long, but I'm really surprised that the Wild brass does not interject when they get the schedule and say, what are you doing? Like, we have how many different...
This is 3 weeks.
How many different stretches of... time off, yet then you pound four games in 3 days at us. Like, it's a little...
The one good thing about this stretch is that it's going to give us time to practice Grailvik maybe Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, get him in there Thursday, and I think he'll be prepped. Because you got to think all the other guys are so far ahead of him at this point. They've got 2-3 weeks more under their belt than what he has, and being a young guy, I think that gives you a few extra days to kind of get him some practice in.
If you look at it, too, we're so proud of ourselves. We're in the state of hockey, and... you know, the Excel Center being there in St. Paul is just an amazing thing that they put in, and it's like helped the whole area to flourish, and it's kind of changed the dynamics of downtown St. Paul. And so what? Because we don't have the tradition, and we are flyover territory nationally. If you look at...
Well, we're continually ranked the number one arena in the NHL.
Yeah, but if
by,
you...
By ESPN. I mean, I don't know.
But if you look at it, can't get any sort of national outdoor game until this year. Can't get them to move us out of the Pacific Northwest Division until it suited their needs to move Detroit to the Eastern Conference to get with the original eight.
It is. And I mean, we can belabor this all day long, but it's money. It all comes down to money.
It's money.
And how it's controlled. And back to the outdoor game, I think, could have been earlier. But we didn't want it against Dallas. I mean, I think Leopold said, no, I don't want to play Dallas. I want to play somebody that's going to bring more national attention.
Yeah, but they never offered the Winter Classic.
Winter Classic, but I think the Stadium Series was offered.
But that's what I'm saying to you. What I'm saying is they brought a team in here.
You're talking about the Winter Classic. I mean, the Winter Classic had I'm an enormous Wild fan. But you're talking about people playing in the Winter Classic that have been around since the 50s. You know, the Wild hasn't been. I'm not that surprised.
But they're doing Washington.
Back when it was one game.
But I'm saying Washington.
And now
right? We
do have a game.
Washington was the ultimate example, though, of a the Washington Capitals.
I'm just saying, when you're talking Maple Leafs, Red Wings, that makes sense to me. I see that.
Sure.
But as much as I hate the Red Wings, but
the other thing is they're doubling back to Boston again.
Yeah, that's frustrating.
You get what I'm saying? Like, you can make an example. You know, maybe we need to pay more dues, maybe whatever. But if you look at it, even a guy like Parise works his ass off, and he doesn't get the benefit of superstar calls. Never does. Right. I mean, like.
Well, we fly under the radar. It's the same way that we play. We don't play big and physical. It's just.
But it's the politics. It's the fucking hockey politics where we don't register as a blip on the map. And that's what's so disappointing. And, you know, it's not for me to be upset.
I don't know if we've done enough to really register at all the time. You know what I mean? Like, I just don't know.
But you
we
can't
are
change
newer
it, though.
And we
you,
haven't, but we, maybe we can. Like,
but you can't go back and have 100 years of history. You can't. You
no,
can never do
no,
that.
But we need to make history now.
Sure.
We need to win now. We need to, you know what I mean? Like, not saying that I'm just trying to play devil's advocate here.
Sure.
I agree with you, and I see where you're coming from, but,
yeah,
you know, but we haven't been around that long, and we haven't won, so...
But they also
maybe we do get flown over a little bit and fly under the radar a little bit until we really do take it to the next level and prove ourselves.
I would just mention, right, that I totally agree with that point, except to say that, like, the business of hockey, the hockey politics, the mix of United States and Canadian economies, and
say what,
right?
Wait, where did this just go?
Especially being Sarah's Canadian, right? And so she's
what
not
about economies, huh?
No. But that dictates the politics in the NHL, right?
Don't even get me started on Canadian conspiracies right now.
But
the hockey Blue Jays just lost, and I got a lot.
I know, but the hockey mecca of the world is Toronto, right? Like, you know, that's what we've kind of decided. When you look at teams circumventing or teams getting special treatment with regard to the salary cap, when you look at opportunities, I mean, this is real stuff I'm talking about. You know, you have Chris Pronger, Philly gets a bailout, and they get to, not only do they get to put this guy on the long-term injury list, but then he's an NHL employee. And then, while he's an NHL employee, not counting against Philly's salary cap, they traded him to Arizona.
All right, I gotta. We're at like almost 90 minutes, so I gotta put a bow on this. So one quick thing, not to leave Teresa out. So MN Soda 24 asked, rather put a third D man on the ice when we have an extra skater. Absolutely, because we have enough D man that function just as well as forwards as D man. So I completely agree.
I agree with her as well.
So that's the last Twitter question I had, and I think we're probably in agreement.
Aaron's gonna kill me if I don't start saying something.
And we're gonna pimp out some other shows, and we're gonna probably go into some exit music and wrap this up.
So number one, you know, we're really excited that we had Kendall on the show tonight. So let's check out the Kendall and Gorg sports ticket show, talking all and everything sports. Really exciting.
I'm gonna be on there tomorrow night. Actually, filling in because Kevin's gonna be at Canterbury.
Yep.
So I'm gonna fill in.
So you can hang out with me.
Savage.
Back to back.
Savage Lord Schweitz. Don't take no shit from him.
Kendall, you will try.
I think we've established that she's not any, like,
okay.
She's not mousy, so I'm sure I'm going to be put in my place.
I think we'll be fine. This was a good test. Also, in that, so you can find that at Alive and Social. And do you guys do that on random nights, or is it always
Thursdays?
No,
yeah, we do it on Monday nights. We do it in studio. We'll be there from 4 to 5 every Monday. And then on Thursdays, we do it at McGovern's here in St. Paul from 5 to 6. Unless it's a game day at home, then we're at 3:30 to 4:30.
Fun. Awesome.
Or just game. Aaron, help me out. It's just game days in general, right? That we're 3:30 to 4:30?
Just at home.
At home. Okay, I was like, wait.
So that you and Kevin can get to work.
Right. So me.
So Scott, you're going to have to start going to check that out before the games then.
I'm going to go check it out. And for all of you that want to see how pretty Aaron is, you can go down and check that out on Thursdays.
Aaron produces that as well.
He'll be there.
1,000% you should check out how pretty Aaron is.
Also on our Snapchat.
So if you have a single lady friend you just want to like retweet this to.
I should talk to my sister about this. I don't know. I'm having dinner with her tonight.
There it is.
Okay, perfect.
He's like, yeah.
The only advanced stat that I know is 1,000% you should check out Aaron.
Other sports shows on our network. Apples to apples. So Scott Applebaum, Dad Applebaum, was
Dad
on the
Applebaum
show with me when Scott Schweitz was out of town.
Black
and actually, Scott O'Malley came on as well. So I
so
had
many
like Scott's.
Scott's.
It was
so
just like
time.
Scott's. So many Scott's to handle. But Applebaum is awesome. And he was super fun to do the show with. And so him and his son have a show. His son goes to Georgetown, I believe. And so they have a show Mondays afternoon. It's like at 2:30 on a Monday afternoon. They talk about everything sports. The amount of listens this show gets is insane. Their following is
like
nuts.
3,000. His orchard. It's crazy.
His orchard. Yes.
Apples to apples, killing it.
They are killing it. And I haven't met the sun, but I doubt that the apple falls far from the tree. So
you'll
have to find out.
Oh, wow.
Hey-o.
All right.
That's top show.
Next week, we're getting a noise for that one.
Did you like that? Okay.
Jeez.
And the other show that I have to talk about, I think I talked about it a bit last week, too, is Story North. We're really going to take everything that we love about Minnesota and put it into one. And everything that I love, because it's literally a book club in a bar. So, Kendall, maybe we should go sometime.
Probably.
You can literally read books, talk about books, and drink. So these are, like, a couple of my favorite things. Especially in winter, what else do you have to do?
Nothing.
I know. So it's hosted by University of Minnesota creative writing professor Kim Todd. And they bop around to different bars and talk about different books. So it's a really cool show. When is that on, Aaron?
Thursdays at 3 o'clock.
And Aaron will be there? Will you be there?
Where? It's a what? It's a podcast. We do it in the studio.
That one's at the studio.
Yeah.
I thought that it was at different bars.
Oh, we got they do it. That's different. Books and bars, check that out too. That's something that they do.
I guess just check out the website too and look into that. Anyways, Apple Far From the Tree, I did really good on that one.
I like that.
I think you did really good on all of them.
And we kind of spoke to this right before we started today, and I'll just make this really quick because I know we got to wrap up. Blah, 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 blah. But, I mean, the thing about podcasts that is so cool is that you can listen to them anywhere. Like, it doesn't matter what you're doing, where you're at. Like, I absolutely love it. There's no commercials. Yeah, in the bathroom.
Not the stool closets.
Mm-hmm. There's no commercials. If you love a specific thing, they're going to preach to that the entire episode. You know, like, if you love the Wild, you're going to preach to it here. If you love books, they're going to preach to it there. You know, I think that that's... I love that about podcasts, and so many people don't understand that. They're like, how does it work? It's not hard, people. Like, you're not an idiot, all right?
Yeah, or people and, maybe don't think it's quite as, like, legit, or, you know, like, it's kind of an right? up-and-coming thing, and not everybody, like, really totally realizes.
Are you two laughing at me because I
some,
call
some
people
idiots? Some people are idiots,
well,
but that's
I mean, they are. Yeah. Like, maybe they don't know. They, you got to have
we're
somebody.
We're not idiots. I don't
the
think.
The fingers are pointing
I mean, maybe
to the
we
gentleman
are.
In the
maybe
room.
Maybe that's why we laughed. Maybe we're
I spend a lot of time
I think
with you
podcasts
guys,
are kind of like, it's kind of like the new, it's the new, like, XM radio. Like, you can literally go to whatever your flavor is. Like, you want 80s? You go to 80s. You sure. want to go to, you want to go to, like, old school rap? They got the Boneyard or whatever the heck they call it. Like, you can go wherever you want. Same with podcasts. You want to, I mean, everybody has their flavor. Books, The Wild, horse racing, I mean, all over the board. Father
so basically,
son connections.
If you know anybody else who listens, likes hockey, loves the Wild, tip them onto our show because I think it's kind of an interesting thing to be getting into as well.
You can find us everywhere. So we have a Facebook.
It doesn't even
page.
Matter about the age. Look at Connie and Merle sitting at home listening to this right now.
Connie and Merle,
my mom
love,
and dad are
love
listening
you too,
right
by
now.
The way.
No
They're
doubt.
Red Wing, he's like 61. Dad, I'm so
Shout
sorry.
Shout
out
to the Mark family.
Hey,
no
hey,
S.
No,
no
S.
S. That's only Kendall because she swears and she snorts.
Outstanding.
While she laughs.
Like, while she laughs. Thank you.
So, yeah, only, so we have a only. Facebook page. Follow us on Twitter at Wild Wednesday Show. Follow us on Snapchat, Wild Wednesday. We've got all sorts of funny stuff on there. And we're always at our favorite place here, Bennett's in St. Paul. Love the food. Love the atmosphere. I mean, it really is a family
He's
feel.
He's good. I like it.
Really want to talk about game nights. They run a shuttle from here. Concerts, they run a shuttle from here. Joe Bennett wants to drive you to any event that's taking place at the Excel Center. And even some in Minneapolis. The other thing
come
is...
Come to my side of town. Come to our side of town.
Hey.
The West Metro. No, don't want to.
Stop
ever.
It.
The other thing is game nights, right? $20 sirloin smothered in mushrooms and onions.
Oh, yeah.
That's making me salivate right now.
So the good. Chopped salad.
Chopped salad is a dream.
It's bomb. Unbelievable.
Wash it down with a cool Summit. Yes. EPA.
Magic. The au gratin potatoes here. I mean, bacon wrapped shrimp that we had last
Ooh,
time.
Those were really
those good.
Good.
The burgers here.
Oh, I had a burger with a crab cake on it last week, which is probably why I have to do this 30-day challenge now. Yeah. But it was so good.
What'd you do? You did yoga?
I highly recommend.
And then you ate a burger with a crab cake?
I did
cake?
Yoga, and then I ate a burger with a crab cake on top.
Outstanding.
And then I was like, okay, this is pointless, but it was so good.
Outstanding.
It was so good. Well, thank you so much to our loyal listeners. And
yes,
Kendall, and thank you so much for being here. Tony Dean, it's always lovely to have you in the hot seat.
And happy Halloween to everybody. Stay safe.
Yeah, I don't think I
check
I
your bags.
You
no, no weird apples, no strange people giving you religious material or all the rest of that stuff.
And some of you, I'll see at the Gopher game. I'll be dressed up like
Go
Belle.
Gopher.
Check your candy.
The yellow dress?
Check your candy. There's creeps out there.
We'll see you guys next week.